Hello, my name is Peter Warren, and today I'm going to be giving a talk on rapid defect detection and classification in images using convolutional neural networks. I am a grad student at UCF. I'm currently pursuing a PhD in mechanical engineering, and this work was very interesting, so I hope you all enjoy it. The layout of the presentation real quick. First I'm going to talk about non-destructive evaluation data gathering techniques in the age of big data and all of the repercussions of that. Then I will get into the dataset details, the dataset that we analyzed, the implementation of convolutional neural networks, and also the testing plan, how we examined our results. And then I'll talk about the results, the accuracy that we received from this convolutional neural network on this specific dataset. Then I will have some conclusionary statements, as well as a brief preview of the future work that we plan on getting into and that we want to get into. So there is a definite need for rapid data processing. On the left-hand side here, we can see a graph for the additive manufacturing market. And we can see how that graph has been growing exponentially for a while and is projected to continue to grow exponentially. And that's just one manufacturing market. Not all manufacturing markets are seeing exponential growth, but all of them are seeing growth and should continue to see growth. And if we look at the graph on the right here, we can see data gathered via NDE. This is data in exabytes gathered through non-destructive evaluation through all of the various types of non-destructive evaluation methods. So in the red, we can see the realistic human processing limit, and in the green, we can see the data gathered. So with all of the research and improvements that go into non-destructive evaluation techniques, and also the capability to store more data, there is ultimately going to be a huge increase in the amount of data that we gather through non-destructive evaluation methods. And this is where there comes a need for either AI-assisted humans or AI complete control over the processing of this data. Because a human can only process so much of this data. They need to be trained in the area which it was gathered and understand it. So I think ultimately an AI-assisted version of this would be an ideal situation. So on this slide, we can see the few different types of non-destructive evaluation listed here. We have visual, which is a picture, ultrasonic, computed tomography, eddy current, magnetic particle, acoustic emission, and liquid penetrant. And these are just a few types of non-destructive evaluation. They're some of the more common types. Each of these methods is going to produce some form of data, whether that's an image, an amplitude, a voltage, which could also be described as an amplitude, and even liquid penetrant, which does not provide an image, but you could certainly take a camera or an image of the testing after it's completed. All of this data here could be stored in a tensor, whether that's fourth or third order tensor, and we can plug that data into a machine learning algorithm or a neural network and be able to process that data or train the neural network to process that data in a more efficient manner than a human would be able to do on their own. So ultimately, there's a lot of talk about digital twin technology over the past few years. And in order for something like a digital twin to occur, we need to not only be able to extract data from the machinery, but also able to process the data in an efficient manner. If we are able to gather a significant amount of data and process that data, then ultimately that is the definition of a digital twin, to have a cyber model of your machinery operating in a cyberspace. And all sorts of calculations could be done on it. And ultimately, what that will lead to is an optimization of the maintenance management schedule, the ability to identify equipment failure. And with a great ability to identify equipment failure, that leads to the identification of the mechanisms that contribute to that failure. And if you identify those, you can calculate and quantify them. And that's ultimately going to lead down the path to an improvement of future designs. So there's a lot of benefits to obtaining a digital twin model. So what is machine learning? Machine learning can be illustrated very easily on this graphic here because it's very similar to traditional programming, although it's somewhat flipped on its head. With traditional programming, what we have is data as an input and then a user-written program as an input. We feed that data into the user-written program and get some type of output. The difference with machine learning is that we have our data and we have the output, the labels, or however we want to classify our data. We can feed that into a machine learning algorithm and it will actually write the program for us. And many times, often is the case, that the program can be more complex and very difficult to write for a user. It's much more efficient to just have a machine learning algorithm write this type of program. So we get a ton of new possibilities with that. And if we quickly go over the seven steps of machine learning, step one would be to gather data, where non-destructive evaluation could be very useful in this process. Steps two and three go hand in hand. We need to prepare the data and choose the model. Depending upon which model we choose, the data needs to be prepared in the correct format in order to be fed into that model and then trained and evaluated. And after we train the model and evaluate it, we can tune the hyperparameters to get a better prediction. The hyperparameters, some examples of that would be batch size, loss function, learning rate, and many other parameters. The amount of layers that we have, the type of neural network, any of these things could be a hyperparameter. And we ultimately want to tune those in order to get the most accurate version of what we want. Okay, so now let's talk about the way that we got our data and where we got it from. And we got it from Kaggle, a competition on Kaggle. And the data was provided by Severstal Steel. The prize money for this competition was $120,000. The competition did take place a few years ago, so it had already finished by the time we started working on it. And basically what the data set is composed of is recently manufactured sheet steel, images of that taken from a high frequency camera. Within the data set, there are 12,000 training images, 5,000 testing images. The size of the image is 1600 by 256 pixels. Each image is either defect free or with defect. So what they want to do is to be able to feed these images into some type of machine learning algorithm and get an output of not only the classification of what type of defect, but the defect also needs to be segmented. So this is a classic segmentation and classification problem. What they want is this to be segmented off and then classified as which type of defect. Right here we can see defect of small divots, and down here we can see a defect which is in ablation. Okay, so now let's perform the preliminary dataset analysis. And although it is not explicitly defined within the competition or the competition description given by Severstal to Kaggle, it would appear after looking at multiple images that type 1 are small divots, type 2 are vertical cracks, type 3 are surface scratches, and type 4 is an ablation. And when we look at the defect occurrence rate, we can get the composition of the data set and how many of each specific defect type occur within the set of data that we're examining. And it would appear that defect type 3 is the most common within all types of defects. And this graph on the right-hand side is showing the number of defects of any type per image. So we have about a 50-50 split between zero defects and one defect, and then a few images which contain two or more defects. Now, the reason that this is given in a 50-50 split is because you want a balanced data set in order to train your neural network. So your data set needs to be about 50-50 in order to train it well. In the manufacturing setting, they're not producing steel with a 50% defect rate. But once your neural network is trained on a balanced data set, you can implement it on an unbalanced data set and it will be able to perform well. Okay, so now I'll give a quick explanation on how we score these neural networks and how to quantify how well the network performs. Now, the main methods for image segmentation and classification used, the main scoring methods, are the dice score and the IOU score. The IOU score is the intersection of union score. And here's an example of why we use these scores. Right here, we have an example of an image taken via satellite, and it's an aerial view of multiple ships. These ships are quite small and difficult to detect with the human eye. However, once we train a neural network to do that, in this case, it's able to do that with 100% accurate classification. Every pixel is described in the correct way. Now, if we just gave it a score of 1 for correct pixel prediction, if this image here is actually accurately predicting or classifying 95% of the pixels. So this would be a score of 95%. However, it is not predicting anything except that there are no ships in the picture. So we can't use a score of just 1 to 1 to describe how well our algorithms are performing. In order to accurately describe them, we're going to need to utilize the dice score and the IOU score. Either one is okay. And what these take into account are the true positives, the false negatives, and the false positives. And you can see that in both of these equations here, there is no account for true negatives. And essentially, we will take the dice score of both negative pixels and each specific classification type. And we can see an example of this calculation done on the next slide. Okay, so we will quickly do an example of the calculation of the previous slide, the ship detection algorithm for both the dice score and the IOU score. Right here, we can see that the IOU score is simply the area of overlap over the area of union, and the dice score is 2 times the area of union over the total number of pixels. Okay, so on the right-hand side of the slide here, we can see that we go through each categorization of pixel and perform the calculation. So for the ships, we do 1, and the background, we do 1, and then we divide that by 2. So area of overlap over area of union, we get 0% for the ships, 95% accurate for the area of overlap. We get the mean IOU, which ends up being 47.5%, which is not a very good score, which is what we would expect when we are not predicting any of the ships within the prediction. So this is a much more accurate representation of how well our algorithm is performing. We do the same thing here with the dice score. It's the same thing. Ships and background both get their own calculation, and then you take the mean of the two scores in order to get your score. For ours, we are doing sheet steel with 4 different types of defect. So there would literally be a calculation for background pixels, defect type 1, defect type 2. So it's an overall mean score with 5 different categories. So let's talk about what is a neural network. A neural network is a series of values which undergo a specific mathematical operation, and the process is updated on the error in the prediction of the labels. The output layer is often a probability indicating some classification of the input layer. This system is often compared to the way a biological brain works. However, our understanding of the biological brain and the neurons which are inside it is very limited, so that's a very vague comparison, but it's a comparison that we often see used. So here at the input layer, we have some type of data, and the output layer is some classification or some function that we want performed to this data. And all of the information will get sent through each of these pathways, and then some error is defined, and it will go back through and recalibrate everything until there is a minimal error. The job is to minimize the error. So a perceptron, if we zoom in on one of these green perceptrons here, takes all of the inputs x from the previous layer and multiplies them by a given weight, and then sums all the values, the weighted sum, and applies some activation function. Right here we can see 2 of the most common activation functions, and basically what these activation functions are put here to do is to take this wide domain of values and squish it all to somewhere between 0 and 1. Sometimes that can change to -1 to 1 or whatever the user wants to do, but 0 to 1 is a very common one because it's very easy to understand. So everything here gets mapped from a very vast domain onto a range between 0 and 1. And once this all goes through, an error function is calculated and the W's are updated. All these weights will be updated in order to obtain an accurate solution to our problem. So on this slide, we see an overall representation of what we would like to accomplish in this work and what we were able to accomplish. So we want to be able to feed these images, these raw images, into our convolutional neural network, although this is just a feed-forward neural network representation here. But we would want to feed it into a convolutional neural network, and then we want the output to be a standard segmentation and classification problem, where we segment the defect and then classify it as the specific type of defect. So on the previous slide, I did mention convolutional neural networks. That is what we want to utilize. And they're great for image recognition, or they're great for this specific type of problem, which was segmentation and classification. So essentially, this is just a stick of data here, this image. It is height over width, and then each pixel has an RGB value, a red, green, and blue value. We can flatten all of those numbers into a one-dimensional vector, and then we can feed that vector into a neural network. But we don't want to directly feed it into a neural network. The first step is to apply convolution and pooling layers prior to the flattening and feeding it into a fully connected neural network. Now, what the convolution does is perform some calculation on a set of squares and puts that into a new, smaller matrix. What the pooling layer does is it'll go back to this and take and do another quick calculation. So normally what we see and what we used in our work is the max pooling, where it just takes the max value. And the reason that we have to follow these convolutional and pooling layers, or put them into our neural network, is because without the convolution, the flattened image vector will have no ability to capture spatial or temporal dependencies. Now, there are no temporal dependencies in this work, but there are spatial dependencies. Each pixel needs to have some information from the other pixels. So that is essentially what this convolutional step is able to accomplish. Okay, so now I will quickly talk about the state-of-the-art convolutional neural network architectures and what those are going to be right now is the ResNet architecture. There are a few others which are comparable to this, but the ResNet was the first big breakthrough in convolutional neural networks. When they were developed in 2015, they won a whole bunch of different competitions that have to do with image recognition, classification, all of the above. Currently, the work has been cited 73,000 times, and it just came out in 2015. This was a very huge development in the world of convolutional neural networks. And essentially what it solves is the vanishing gradient problem. So before, we were not able to have deep neural networks. Once you reach a certain depth, a certain amount of layers within a neural network, the gradient would vanish, and it would essentially render the later levels within the neural network useless. And by using these skipped connections, where it takes a little bit of information past a few layers and feeds it into the later layer, so it holds on to its identity function here, this allows the gradient to not vanish, and essentially you can have a deeper neural network. So you get the benefit of a deeper neural network without losing the gradient. So this was a huge development, and it's what we used in our work to classify our images and segment our images. So this slide illustrates how powerful these convolutional neural networks can be, and this is the results of our work here. By training a convolutional neural network on this data set, we're able to accurately segment and classify each of these images. Here we have two examples of defect type 1, which were the small divots, defect type 2, which were vertical cracks, defect type 3, which was the surface scratches, and defect type 4, which was the ablations. And by having this ability to accurately segment off the portion which is defected and then classify it is a huge ability, and you could you don't have to have a lot of imagination to see all of the possibilities that could come from something like this if it is implemented in the manufacturing industry, and of course other industries as well, but especially the manufacturing industry. So on this slide, we're going to be able to quantify how well our algorithm performed numerically. Right here, we have the IOU score, the loss function, and the loss function used was the binary cross-entropy loss function. The optimizer function was the atom function. And also we have the dice score listed here. We have this listed for both the Resnet18 and the Resnet50. The 18 is indicative of how many layers are within the convolutional neural network. So 18 here and 50 here. We used a batch size of 2, a learning rate of 0.0005. The hardware used here, we rented some space on the Google Cloud. We used 8 CPUs with 30 gigabytes of RAM and an NVIDIA Tesla T4 GPU. So here we can see on the epochs, and just for anyone who doesn't know, an epoch is one complete cycle through the data, an entire cycle through every image within the data set. And after around 30 epochs, we can see convergence within the training. Now, the training does converge at around 30. That's for both the dice score and the IOU score, since the calculation is very similar. And the loss function is a little harder to see, but it also converges at around 30 and stabilizes there. It took a total of maybe 6 hours to train the Resnet18, and it took about 12 hours to train the Resnet50. Here we can see the scores. Now the top score is the score for the winner of the competition, which took place about a year and a half to 2 years ago. They scored a 0.92 and a 0.91 on the public, a 0.92 on the public and a 0.91 on the private. Our Resnet18 was able to get a 0.85 and a 0.87, and the Resnet50 was able to get a 0.86 and a 0.88. So these scores are very close. One thing I'll mention is that the private data set is a data set which the public does not have access to. You simply submit your code to Kaggle and they will run your code on a data set which nobody has any access to. So our 0.88 score was very close to the top score of 0.91. And this is just using a straight off the shelf Resnet18 and Resnet50 architecture. The way that you're going to get these higher scores is by performing a soft voting function with multiple models, and it's a very complex process. In order for a benchmarking, we thought it prudent to just run the Resnet18 and the Resnet50 to give an accurate representation of how well these architectures perform on this specific data set. Okay, so I'm running out of time here, but I do want to talk about our future work, future project that we are hoping to work, or we are working with Siemens on. And essentially what we're going to be looking at is metal 3D printing. We already have some samples printed. They're essentially just cubes. Some have cooling holes. Some have unique geometries. And we want to be able to utilize neural networks to tackle the sintering problem. So after these metallic cubes are printed, they need to go into the sintering oven, and they're going to shrink at a somewhat unknown rate. They don't just shrink in a constant or uniform manner based on the printing directions and everything else. It's very hard to quantify how much these cubes are gonna shrink once they go into the sintering oven. So we're gonna utilize CT scans and take images of that and hopefully get some method of quantifying the shrinkage or get a better prediction of shrinkage utilizing artificial intelligence and neural networks. Some quick acknowledgments. I'd like to acknowledge my advisor, Dr. Rana J. Ghosh, and my two lab mates, Hossein Ali and Hossein Ibrahimi. Everyone in this slide helped me a tremendous amount with this work. And also a big thank you to Kaggle, obviously, for providing this data set, as well as Severstal. And thank you to Siemens for becoming interested in this and seeing if we can utilize it in a real world problem in the future. Some references here. And thank you. Do you have any questions?